This is Johnny Cash. As you were listening to the Grand Canyon Suite, you probably noticed here and there throughout this new recording by Andre Kostelanetz a few sounds that obviously were not made by members of his orchestra. I'd like to tell you how they got there. If you'd been standing on the lip of the Grand Canyon one August afternoon, you might have seen the return of a rather unusual expedition. That mule train consisted of a guide, a Columbia recording director, an engineer, photographer, and three pack mules named Colba, Diana, and Juanita, carrying 250 pounds of recording equipment. They'd been down in the bottom for 3 days trying to capture the elusive and particular sights and sounds of the Grand Canyon. And this bunch of energetic professional people looked pretty done in as they struggled up past that rim, back on the way to the hotel and cool showers, with soft beds and that much-needed sleep. August is a rough month to plan an expedition into the canyon. The heat at the bottom reaches as high as 150 degrees during the day, and when night falls, it drops down to only about maybe 100. But there was a very good reason for their coming out in August. They badly wanted the sound of a storm in the canyon, and August is the storm season out here. That's the baby they were after, but when they got there, they were told that it hadn't rained at the bottom of the canyon in something like 11 months. Well, they decided to get what they could of the canyon sounds and hope for the best. Before they started down, they set up their equipment for necessary testing, and while they were at it, picked up a few of the sounds at the top of the canyon. You know, there's an updraft all the time coming up out of the heat down there at the bottom, and that makes for a constant wind that whips at the scrubby pine trees on the canyon edge. Just listen. But these days, most of the sounds at the top of the canyon are human. Listen to this section of tape made just at dawn. You'll hear the civilized sounds of a lady's high heels tapping their way down the walk as the eternal canyon crickets sound their quiet song to the morning sun. About 9 o'clock, we saddled up and started the long descent. The guide takes the lead mule, and you trot off in single file. In case you didn't know it, about the only way you can get down into the canyon's on muleback. The trip down is accomplished by a series of switchbacks. That means you go a little way down a narrow trail in one direction. Then you turn out over a ledge that drops off sheer, maybe a couple of thousand feet. And you go down a little more in the opposite direction. The heat rising out of the canyon is like from a giant furnace. To take your mind off of your troubles, you look at the rock strata, limestone, sandstone, shale, granite, all formed when this whole part of the world was under the sea. It's like a cutaway section of the Book of Time. Each level is a different color and texture. Nowhere in the world is so much of the Earth's history exposed to view. They say that 1 mile down the side of the canyon represents roughly about 1 billion years in the geological formation of the Earth. But your mind is brought back to the present when your mule stops to snatch a little greenery in the middle of a hairpin switchback with both ends hanging out in space. Before you've gone too far, you come to the first of the resting places, where Bright Angel Creek runs down over the rocks. You dismount and drink and wash up in that cool water. Then for a moment you look out at the canyon, and now you look up, too. The sky is receded back between the cliff sides. Your normal, everyday world is already pretty far away. Down below, you meet larger streams as they gush and tumble, falling down toward the Colorado. But for the most part, going down into the canyon is just a matter of sticking to the back of that grunt, a matter of sticking to the back of that grunt, a matter of sticking to the back of that grunt, a matter of sticking to the back of that grunt, a matter of sticking to the back of that grumpy burrow that seems so much more interested in his own welfare than yours. Then finally, your mule train approaches a narrow suspension bridge high above the mighty Colorado. For a moment, you hang there, poised over this rushing torrent, fascinated with the power of it. Then on you go to make camp and rest your mules. It's been 5 hours or more, and maybe it's not the most comfortable ride in the world, but it has one big compensation. It feels so darn good when you finally can get there and get off. After resting a spell, we moved on down to the Colorado again, and our recording director and engineer used some stepping stones to take a mic right out into the middle of the current. Friend, that's a pretty hazardous trick to pull off, because the current in the Colorado is so strong and the water's so full of silt and grit that to fall in it is very risky business. You can hear our portable one-cylinder generator putt-putting away there, too, and the voices of the men as they call to each other. The sky was clear and cloudless that night, with a big moon shining down and no sign of even a sprinkle. The only sounds we did get were a few birds and crickets way down at the bottom of the canyon. Did you ever try to make a mule sing a solo? Well, that's how we spent our next day. But for some reason or other, Juanita and Dinah and Colva just didn't feel too musical that day. Finally, one of the guides down there suggested that we take two mules, who were what you might call buddies, and work a little trick on them. So one of them we staked to a tree with microphones all around him so that wherever he turned, he'd be on mic. Then we led his buddy around and out of sight. And after a while, we brought him back into view about half a mile away. And sure enough, just as his buddy disappeared out of sight again, our recording mule called out to him, we got our performance. Then we taped the other mule trains coming down to the camp during the afternoon. We set up two mics along the trail about 50 yards apart for this to get our stereo effect. In the background, you can hear the roar of that old Colorado. Just listen. But once again, we went to sleep with that bright, round moon shining in our eyes and not much hope of seeing anything better than a heavy dew. We dozed off listening to those noisy crickets. About 3 a.m, our recording director suddenly sat bolt upright in bed. Something had happened. Well, what had happened was just that the bright moonlight suddenly wasn't there anymore. Big, heavy thunderheads were racing over us. The engineer dashed out and got the equipment started just in time, and we didn't have to wait long. Pretty soon, here came a low growl from away back behind the cliffs. And with that came the first big, fat drops of water that always seemed to warn of the approach of a cloudburst. And all of a sudden, the storm broke directly over us. In 5 minutes, it was all over. The heavy clouds rolled out on past the canyon. The moon poked its head out and shone just as brightly as before. Its rays reflected on the thousands of little streams that came falling down through the rocks. As we began to pack up for the trip back to the top, the first little hints of daybreak were in the air. The crickets once more struck up their scratchy hosannas. And as we watched, the whole eternal sequence of day began again. A new dawn breaking over this gigantic marvel of nature. One more day in the life of an eternal miracle, the Grand Canyon.